Hey guys, this is Dangun123, and welcome to...
TankCast!
Hello everyone, and welcome to the next exciting episode of TenchiCast, presented by TenchiForum.com. With me today is a great cast of people. I have Chuck.
Hey!
Evil Pie.
Hello everyone.
JG Zim.
We want more duel.
Kyoka.
I like insanity.
L.
Hello there.
And Mittens.
Muffins!
When an anime series gets big, a manga counterpart is always there to complement it. And for Tenchi, that was done by one Hitoshi Okuda, and like every other person who's gotten behind the characters, gave them his signature twist. The manga introduces many new characters, some reoccurring and some once and done. Which new character is your favorite and why?
Alright, starting it off good. Well, first off, I would just want to note that I think Okuda does a fantastic job with the cast, the main cast as it is. They feel exactly like we already were accustomed to. They feel like the same characters we've known in the anime for years. And the addition of several reoccurring characters and new characters fit so well with these casts. They react exactly like you would expect. And it just feels great to have new characters added in a way that is really pleasing to the fans and makes sense. As for the new characters, I mean, there's so many to choose from, but for me, it's always going to be Minagi. And for those of you who don't know, Minagi is a Ryoko clone. She was created by another new character, recurring character named Yakagi, who is sort of like a Kagato-esque fellow student of Washu. And Minagi is very different from Ryoko, however. She's much more of a sweetheart, and she fits in very well with the cast, and she eventually even becomes a space pirate of her own, although she fights for the underdogs and against the rich corporations. So you could sort of say, like, a Robin Hood in space, almost. But what really gets me about Minagi is that she's such a good complement to Ryoko. Ryoko is brash and bold, whereas Minagi is slightly more reserved, thoughtful, and much more open with her emotions, and very caring. So in those ways, it's Minagi for me all the way.
As Chuck said, there's a wide variety of characters to choose from, and choosing one is very difficult. I can look at the list. We've got Minagi and Yakage, who Chuck has already told us about. We also have Yume and the Shima brothers. We've got a girl who was sweet on Tenchi, and I'm not going to spoil that story, but she's really early on. And then you have Garyu, and you have Ibarra. I keep looking at all the lists and seeing all these great characters, so I have to go ahead and give a shout-out to one of the underdogs who is not represented very well, and that's my boy Ibarra. Ibarra comes from a full-volume story in Volume 9, The Quest for More Money. Ibarra is a young Jiraiyan man who has been left on a planet to guard the Nameless Tree, essentially for the rest of his life, or until another knight or surrogate comes to take his place. And he looks like, kind of like Minagi, he's an older version of Tenchi. And he looks a lot like Tenchi, and as the story goes, there's some connection between him and Ryoko. Again, no, I'm not going to spoil that story for you, because I expect you to go read it. But the idea is that you get to see a more mature version of what you could call a more mature version of Tenchi, where he's not only more muscular, he's more refined, he is also in control of all his abilities, but you get to see kind of a more mature character in this group, as opposed to the usual slapstick love triangle goodness you get with the rest of the cast. And so that's where my heart goes to for the moment, is you see the more mature romance between Ibarra and the object of his affection, who is Ryoko.
What was the name of the... which I'll state up here up front for those listening, that unfortunately I was only able to go through the complete series once, so my brain is about as rusty as, you know, Optimus Prime after Cosmic Rust. So what was the name of the character that was the monk and the kind of like the Dryan woodcarver's daughter? You have Gohei, and then you also had the prince of the planet that was dying, who captured Aika. You know, there's a couple good ones in there. I think those were my favorite characters of the new cast, at least of the reoccurring ones. Yeah, those are probably the two or three that I like the best.
Out of all the characters, I don't know. I probably quite like Minagi quite a lot. She does appear quite a lot in it, so her character's more fleshed out than some of the others who only appear like a few times, like Gohei the monk. He's not in it as much as Minagi, so yeah, probably I'd have to go with Minagi.
There were a lot of characters I liked, but I'm going to go with, I'm just going to say I like the villains, because he wrote really interesting villains, I liked Garyu, because I liked the Aika arc, so yeah.
JG, the monk, his name was Goji, yeah, and Garyu was the prince of the planet who was dying, who kidnapped Aika and brainwashed her. That was a good arc too. That one was toward the end of the first season.
Now the prince of Akutu.
The Garyu arc still stands as one of my favorites.
Yeah, that's a darn good one, and that one gets overlooked too. I mean, that one's it's sort of sandwiched in between the Yume arc and the Dark Washu arc, and those are two of the most popular ones. So that one sort of gets forgotten, which is a shame too, because that's a really good one.
I think the whole arc that dealt with Jiraiya tree builders, woodworkers, or whatever, woodcarvers family that dealt with it, gave you a better look at Jiraiya and some of the other things going on, and you had some good Yosho moments in there, among other things, so it stood out to me as a just an overall good arc period. There wasn't anything that you really lacked in it.
Yeah, that was the Yume arc. It was still stands as the longest arc in the series, and it was a damn good one.
Yeah, that one goes by like two different names, because that one can sort of be split up into two mini arcs, because the first one deals with Ryuten, which is the name of that planet, and then only after 2.5 volumes is it revealed that the whole thing was a plot of Yume, and then it sort of becomes the Yume arc. But yeah, that the longest one, and it's one of the best ones.
Of course, we got those little short and sweet ones. I mentioned Hiwa earlier. She was in love with Tenshi, and she died young. And as such, she's a spirit, and she essentially puts Tenshi, Aika, and Ryoko into this simulator thing. I think Washu helps out with this, to essentially put her heart at peace, so that she has Ryoko and Aika realize that they need to take care of Tenshi for her.
Yeah, I think that was the saddest one. That one had me tearing up a bit. That was a good one. I don't know if you want to keep going along this train of thought, because I mean, the next question sort of is about which story is your favorite. I mean, this is good scatterbrain stuff in here, but
I don't know. The saddest arc I thought was the one where the little girl wanted to see Tsunami, and her her heart got transplanted.
My favorite character is Yume. Possibly helped by the long arc she had to herself that fleshed out her character. I quite liked her arrogance and pride. It made her look comedic and at times sort of fitting the evil scientist role. And I must say, her character design was brilliant too. I guess I'm just attracted to evil-like characters.
Well, as far as the new characters, I'm not completely knowledgeable about everyone, obviously, but I was really a fan of Yukage. I thought that his quest to make the perfect sword was really cool. He wasn't like Kagato in that he was completely evil. He wasn't completely evil. He would just do things by any means necessary. But on that same token, he didn't do things just because he had a sick fascination with destroying people or seeing people deconstructed or anything like that. He was very much all he was centered on was the perfect sword, and I really liked his design from an artistic aspect. I thought it was really cool. I was a fan of Minagi, but Yukage was the one I think really put over the first arc for me. The manga consists of several multi-volume arcs separated by many shorter stories, both sweet and sad. Which of these stories most resonated with you, and why?
Well, I have to be the one to pull out my favorite arc, which is the Garyu arc. As much as I love the long Yume arc, as well as the introductory arc for Minagi, the Dark Washu arc, and many of the other, even the ending arc with when Masaki Kiyone shows up at the very end, all those arcs are good, but the one with Garyu, the Prince of Oku 2, stands out in my mind because it answers one question that's been burning on my mind forever. You always see Ryoko and Ayaka at odds with each other. They tease. They'd even sometimes blow up rooms and apartments just to get their frustrations out. And then many times you see Ryoko going full space pirate on something, terrorizing a planet. Again, this is OVA series Ryoko, who could seriously take on Jirai by herself if she really chose to. But on the other side, you always see Ayaka's really quiet and always keeps her powers under wraps until she gets too pissed, and then she blah power everywhere. But you never see her lose control. You never see her essentially abuse her abilities, you never see the full potential of what she can do. In the Garyu arc, she's mind controlled by this young man by the name of Garyu, Prince of a Dying Planet, Oku 2. And when she's under his power, all of her love and all of her affection towards Tenshi is turned towards Garyu instead. She is absolutely devoted to him. In which case, he tells her, go kill Tenshi. You see full splash pages of Ayaka with death in her eyes, which is something you never see anywhere else in the franchise. You see Ayaka fight Tenshi to a standstill sometimes. Now, keep in mind, he's not using the Lighthawk wings, and he is holding back, but Ayaka can hold her own, and it's something that you never see is Ayaka really angry, except I think you see her once when she fights Kagato, who's way above her level. But that scene shows Ayaka in a completely different light than you see most of the rest of the franchise, which I really loved that interpretation of her.
It's a close call, but I'd have to go with the Yume arc. And my reasons are, it had such a strong plot and fitted in the best of the Tenshi-verse. It was well paced out, and the new characters didn't seem out of place. Usually with new characters, especially female, people show negativity towards them. Kuda never worked on the anime, but it clearly showed he knew the characters. And he also knew things about Jirai we didn't complain about. But the close tie was between that and the very short Mitsu story, and I thought that was really, really good, because, I mean, Jirai is this most powerful empire. You think, oh, the last thing that's going to threaten it is a cute little creature, but what's so threatening is it eats Jirai trees and it feeds on Jirai power. And I thought that was a really good twist, instead of like, oh, some super machine or a super sheep. No, it's just a cuddly little creature.
The Yume arc is, you know, incredibly good. It's I think the longest one there, and it's well written. But I don't know, I think I'll go for the Dark Washu arc, because I quite like that, with, you know, like one of Washu's inventions from the past going back to terrorize and stuff. And it was quite good to see Washu get a bit more, you know, main storyline.
Oh man, where to begin? I mean, I'm a fan of all three types of stories, the big long arcs and the short and sweets, as I call them, and the short and sads. First, I guess I'll weigh in on which arc is my favorite, because that seems to be what everyone's going for. My favorite arc was, we call it the unnamed tree arc, which is the volume called the Quest for More Money. And just like Pi was saying, it offers a new, the Garyu arc offers a new look at Ayaka. Well, the unnamed tree arc really gives us a new look at Ryoko that we really have never seen before or since, because she is all of a sudden having these memories, these flashbacks of a time when she was under Kagato's control, and where she encountered this man who looks just like Tenshi, and he made such a strong impact on her that she's remembering him now, and it's really throwing her into like an emotional crisis, because she's thinking to herself, well, is the only reason I like Tenshi because I remember this man? And so it really, you really see her in a crisis of the soul. it really reveals depths of her character that we haven't seen before in the anime. And of course the arc is just badass all on its own. They go and they find this unnamed planet with this rejected dry tree without a name, and they meet its guardian, who's the man that Ryoko remembers, and he's still in love with her after all this time, but she doesn't remember him very well. And so it leads to some good tension between the three of them, between the man, Ibarra, and Tenshi and Ryoko. So it's actually quite cool to see Tenshi thrown into the love triangle in a way that he's never been. He's usually very passive, but in this one, he actually shows a bit more interest. And it's, along with Ryoko's character change, it's quite a refreshing view on the whole love triangle theme of Tenshi. So that would be my favorite arc, but the favorite story, the one that really hit me the most, I'm going to have to agree with Kyoka and say that the Mitsu story. It was only one or two issues long, but that one really, really had me almost in tears by the end. That one was so sweet and so bitterly sad at the end, and it was just something else. And just like Kyoka says, it was a great plot element to have these little creatures be this grave threat to Jirai. But what really got me was the friendship that Aiko was eventually able to have with this little creature. It sort of became like a counterpoint to Ryoko and Ryooki. And I just thought it was a really good balance and a new play on Aika's character, showing her more caring side toward this creature. And like I said, I won't spoil the ending, but it's very, very sad, and it really hit you in the gut, really. And so that's the one that I always remember the most when I think of the manga stories.
I can't really say I necessarily have a favorite. I mean, I really do like the Ryuten arc with the tree builders. I mean, I keep hitting on that just because, yeah, it's long and all that. And then my second, I guess, would probably be the one with the the Prince of the Dying Planet. And, what he did with Aika, and of course you've got the mystery tree in there. But I think overall, it's not so much a single arc that I liked as much as the small nods hidden everywhere across all of the volumes. It's not a single thing, but the sum of its parts. You know, there's a little nod in there when Lady Finaho comes visiting, or when, we get to see her in a different light. And there's a bunch of different parts of Yosho being badass one-handed while he's, carrying a baby in one arm. And, there's this part with Ryoko and Tenshi with the nameless tree powering up and, defeating everything. And there's a little part in there that explains why does the Tenshi Misaki family have all these freaking carrot fields? Well, it's because that's how they pay for everything and they keep afloat. So he constantly farms carrots. And they're well known throughout Japan as the Misaki carrots. There's just time after time after time where there's these little footnotes in there that tie everything together. And beyond that, then you even have a lot of pokes at the OVA and Kajishima's story where it doesn't make sense. And this author is going through and saying, hey, this would make more sense if we do it this way. Snicker, snicker. So I think overall, I have to say it's a sum of a bunch of different elements, not maybe just one story that sells it for me.
My favorite character is Mihoshi, and I really liked how he wrote Mihoshi as a character, and I like the story where Mihoshi picks that she's getting married to Tenshi for her dying grandma. I don't know, it was sad, and Tenshi was such a sweetheart, and there are a ton of other short Mihoshi stories, like where she's learning how to drive and doing horrible but still passing, and where she tries to talk the bank robber out of being a bank robber. I don't know. Those are the ones I liked.
After the end of the second OVA, the manga was left as the only regularly continuing telling of the Tenshi story for many years, charting its own path and standing on its own, independent of Tenshi's previous writers. Did this enhance or detract from your experience? And if so, in what ways?
Well, I don't really have much to say to this. I think even before and after, it still stands today as brilliant. And I always say this, it should have been OVA 3, because it's just miles and miles better than that.
Oh man, this one's near and dear to my heart, because as you say, after the second OVA was done and Universe was done and Tokyo was done, it was pretty much outside of the movies and the doujins in Japan, who all knows them, I mean really they're obscure, but other than those, after the last movie and between that and OVA 3, there was no new Tenchi material being released in any significant quantity except for the manga. And it sort of rises to the challenge, and it stands on its own two feet after that time, as it pretty much says to the world, yes, I am the Tenchi continuation. And it really shows in the writing. They're completely confident being able to go out and write on their own outside of the established Kajishima canon and the universe canon, and it works well. They do give nods to the OVA canon, which is what it's originally based off of, but they're not slaves to it, and it really works well, I think, especially in the world building that they do. I mean, we see planets like the Ryuten planet, the planet that builds the dry trees into ships, and stuff that we would never have seen in the OVA. And it's pretty much, I've said it for a while now, the two series of the manga is pretty much at least a good 3 or 4 seasons worth of Tenchi material if it were animated. And it really feels like it maintains its strain all the way along. Really never goes old. And it's really good to see, especially for those who get to the end of the OVA and universe and wonder, well, why isn't there any more? Well, there is. It's just on the printed page rather than on the screen. And I think a lot of people would really benefit if they're feeling a bit let down after the end of Universe or the OVA, that they should then turn to the manga, because, I mean, it just keeps going. It goes and it stays strong for over 10 years worth of manga stuff in there. And I think it really stands well on its own. And I'm glad that we had something in that gap between Tenchi releases.
I guess for anybody who watched OVA 3 and went, what the frack? Just, you know, maybe blank that out of your mind. I mean, eventually we'll have to return to that universe and the carnival will come around again, but I really think it would be appropriate for maybe Kajishima to now, as we've constantly called it, pull a George Lucas and maybe hand off the license or the series to somebody else at this point. And in which case, I think it would be a great disservice if they did not pull directly from or at least reference the manga, because, you know, as Chuck said, every part of it, the only part I was really disappointed with in the manga is maybe you could have used Kiyone Makabe in there. And the ending of the very last second series book is kind of weak. But other than that, I mean, it's an enjoyable ride. There's nothing really to say negative about it. It's core Tenchi. It's the stuff that we expected from OVA 1 and 2 continuing on. Being a manga format, it is a little bit, you could say, a little bit more of a light-hearted style, I think. You know, rather than maybe some of the darker elements like Kagato floating around, but it's still very well illustrated. It still holds up very well today. It would be great to see if somebody would go through and reprint it for today's audience, now that Tenchi's coming back through, you know, with Funimation testing the waters, essentially, with War on Geminar and some other things. So, I mean, overall, if you like Tenchi, read the darn manga. If you haven't, you're missing out.
I would say that reading the manga actually enhanced my experience in the entire thing, because, as Chuck said, it does a good job of world building. It does a lot of what you would expect a manga to do. Usually when you have an anime, and this is actually a fact that gets overlooked, most anime series that you see were, in many cases, manga first. For example, Dragon Ball was a manga first. Akira was written as a book first. I think Record of Lotus War, if I remember correctly, was a light junior novel as well as a manga before it became animated as well. So you have the tradition is usually book first, anime second. Tenchi went the other way around. You had anime first, which was the original OVA, OVA series or series one, and then the manga was started shortly afterward, along with like Hasegawa's novels and what have you. But I actually think that the manga did a very good job of expanding the universe, kind of like Chuck mentioned with George Lucas. It's kind of the expanded universe. It kind of goes off on its own little thing, explores aspects and takes the time to explore aspects that maybe you hadn't thought about, like Ryuten, thought about what other planets are out there besides the Jiraiyan Empire. That's where you have like Garyu showing up. And so you have all this expanded universe that the manga explores that no one's had a chance to. And it answers certain questions, one of the later questions in this podcast is when we start talking about some of the things that were original to the manga that are not in any other franchise or any other part of the franchise. They explored with a lot of ideas that had not been played with, and I think it actually made it better. And I think it made it a lot better.
Plot-wise, character-wise, and dialogue-wise, it is on perfectly equal footing with the OVA series 1 and 2 and Universe. I mean, it goes completely in hand with them, and yeah, it makes the whole Tenchu Universe better for its existing.
I have to agree with everybody else here, and I agree that enhanced, and like back in 2001, you know, I was obsessed with Tenchi and everything was Tenchi, and you know, after the series, it's like I would go to the bookstore and search for the manga and bought a lot of it there, and I really like what it could have brought to the show. And
I would have to say, from my reading experience, it very much enhanced the franchise for me. Okuda really knows the characters. Like Naoko Hasegawa, he knows what will make the characters sad or happy. He knows when they will do this or when they will do that. Okuda's also smart enough to figure out how to insert his own style into it without conflicting with the core of the characters at all. You know, we see that throughout the manga, and from what I've heard and haven't read and have read, he really knows his stuff. Like, he really knows how each character will react to a certain situation, what villains will help get the Tenchi cast over with everybody, you know, as like the underdogs and coming up. He knows how to not make it to where they're untouchable, where they're, for lack of better words, Mary Sues. He knows that they need to have faults as well as have strong points. And he knows how to show the reader, oh, hey, and build them up and build them down. He's a fantastic writer, and he knows exactly what he's talking about. I don't really feel that any part of it detracted from me, from the majority of the Tenchi franchise. There were a few parts of it I wasn't 100% on, like the fact that they referred to Ryoko as a machine a lot of the time. Like, oh, well, her brain is on the fritz again or whatever. She's just a machine. And I thought that was kind of like you really didn't have to keep poking on that point. Like, I realize that she was made from mass and she wasn't made in the traditional sense of what we'll call a being, but I mean, that was just a little bit like while she would refer to her in a condescending sense, not like she doesn't do that for a lot of characters, but that was just kind of like, okay, I get the point. You don't have to keep harping on with that. But other than that, yeah, I think that Okuda should be considered, with everything else in the franchise, as, you know, a big part of the franchise. Anybody who's a Tenchi fan should read the manga, because it's, if you have an itch for Tenchi, read the manga. It'll fix it. With the sheer quantity of material available from the manga, do you think it would be a good idea for someone to come along and animate any of it?
Oh gosh, I think I already answered that. Boy. It would be, I mean, yes, it needs to be animated, period. I'd much rather see this as its own continuity, branching off of the OVA, as another side series like Universe or Tokyo. There's a lot of it that the manga kind of pulls from Universe in the way of its kind of reading material or something. I think the Okuda pulled, you know, he looked at both Tenchi Universe and the OVA 1 and 2, and then went from there and did his own thing to some degree. But what story would be the best to start it out with? That's really, really difficult to say. I have to keep harping on it, but probably the Ryuten arc with the tree builders, because even though it is a very long arc, it mixes a lot of stuff. It's got the kind of a adventuring flair to it. And there is a lot of material there, I think, that would hook enough people into it to continue on with either additional add-ons or something. If they wouldn't go through and do a new series based on that, I would say just make a bunch of little one-offs episodes, like real, you know, Tenchi family, you know, the adventures of Tenchi or whatever, and company, and do a lot of these little side stories about what's going on in the day-to-day life, like bonus episodes or something that you'd see in another series, and just wrap them all together and then sell it off like that. I mean, that probably wouldn't be the distributor companies like Funimation's probably preferred way of doing something, but you can sell it off that way and make a lot of fans happy and interested in it again, and show it on television with random episodes, and there's no super big overlying plot to have to dive into, or, you know, catch us next week to figure out what the frack happened. And I don't know. I think it could work as a standalone thing, and that way you don't have the whole conflict with the OVA universe. Make a bunch of side stories. Make the whole thing. Just get on with it and let's see it.
Yes, all of them, please. I want to see Ayaka with the original hair and all the cute stories with Mihoshi, and it would all translate pretty well to TV.
It definitely needs to be animated. Probably won't happen, but if it does, I mean, if you just do the Minagi and Yume arc, that's basically like a full series there in itself.
I'm going to have to totally agree with everyone here. Animate the darn thing already. I mean, it's right there. You don't even need to spend a lot of money to come up with a new story. You've got 10 years worth right there staring you in the face. As for how it should be animated, I mean, if we're going to do as JG and L say, some of the larger arcs are probably going to have to start with the first one, because that's the one that introduces a lot of the themes and a lot of the recurring characters like Minagi. But I also agree with JG that a lot of these little one-shot stories would work brilliantly as like special episodes, a la the Mihoshi episode, the Mihoshi special. Other than that, what I think would be the best one ever to be animated, either in like movie form or maybe like a mini-series, would be the Unnamed Tree arc. And I know I've already said a lot about that already, but that one has everything that you could want from Tenchi. It has the romance, it has a new look at Ryoko and all the other characters, it has action, it has Ryoko's past catching up with her, it's got world building with the Unnamed Tree. And it's just long enough. It's exactly one volume of the manga, so about six issues. That is just long enough that I think it could probably be fit really well into a movie or like a TV movie or something. And that's the one that I would start with, because that one doesn't have any of the previous recurring characters. And it's, I think, the best one, just totally encapsulated story of the arcs.
The Yume arc's obviously getting my vote. I mean, I've already said how good it is, and I mean, it's long enough to be a movie, possibly. I'd love to see Yumi's henchmen and Yumi herself animated. And I mean, the favourite scene that I would be on the edge of my seat would be the end with the Black Hawk wings. That's such an edge of your seat moment. I just think that's the best story to represent the Akuda's brilliance, just making up a story. And he's not the creator, it just shows that you don't have to be the head honcho to do the best.
I think everyone here has already stated that we need this animated as soon as possible. The question again becomes how to do it, as Chuck and others have already illustrated. Chuck in particular, I believe, is correct in stating that we should start with Yakage and Minagi, for sure. That would be a great way to reintroduce everyone, because the start of that issue has a quick recap, not unlike the way OVA 3 did, but a little bit more brief, just kind of getting the people's feet on the ground as to who we are and what we're going to do. But it depends on what kind of series you want out of this. Because this series, again, the manga has so many different aspects to it and so many different feels to it that choosing which way to go is very, very tricky. So you have the big long arcs, the action-oriented arcs. You have the short and sweets. You have the short and sads. I actually think was it JG or Chuck who said that this could easily be made into a series of specials or maybe into one-shot OVAs. They've done that with a lot of series. The Dragon Ball movies are essentially that way. They don't really have anything to do with each other. They're all kind of off-continuity arcs. Bleach has done the same thing with movies that are set out of continuity. Also, Viz, when they originally published this, published the manga in the States, made a single volume that was called Sasami Stories. And all it was a bunch of the cute stories that were just Sasami. Most of them are one chapter long. They're just cute little shorts that say, here's Sasami doing something that you wouldn't have expected. Which actually, one of the good Sasami story arcs was The Chef of Iron, where she was going against, I believe it was Kazuma Kagato. It was a young child version of Kagato who has no which, by the way, the manga makes a very big point. This has no relation to the Kagato from the OVA. But you have this cooking contest between Sasami and Kagato. No special powers, no exploding worlds, no galactic travesties are happening here. It's just a straight up cooking contest. In fact, it's Chef of Iron. It's of course a knock against Iron Chef. But you have so much variety into what kind of stories you want. So where would you start? Yukage and Minagi, I would agree, would be a good place to start. Where to go from there, where you go from little shorts or to the big long arcs. If you wanted to go with big long arcs, the ones that I would want to see animated would definitely be the Unnamed Tree arc, which is Ibarra's story arc. You could also go with the evil Ayaka, the Garyu arc, where Ayaka's mind control. That's another good one. Both of those show sides of Ayaka and Ryoko, respectively, that are very, very poignant, not really been explored. That'd be something new for fans to see if they haven't read the manga before. That would be something to see animated that they have never seen and be completely new material for them. Also, some of these little shorts and sweets where you do world building, where you, there was an episode, or not an episode, a chapter where Ryoko takes a fighter under her wing and proceeds to train him, and you get to see all these different training sequences with Ryoko sitting on his back as he does push-ups and this, that, and the other, and I'm not going to spoil that story arc, but that's a little one-off for one character. You have all these nice little episodes that could easily be, I don't want to say it because it's a very bad word to use, but filler season. Essentially, if you want to have just an bunch of random episodes you can sew at random times with no connection to each other, the manga's full of them. You could definitely fill a season of just random stories. Now, if you want the big, long story arcs, the Yume arc, I could definitely see the first half of the arc with on Ryuten being a season, have a cliffhanger where Yume is introduced, and having the next season deal with her, and that climaxed with the Black Lighthawk wings at the end. Similarly, the Unnamed Tree arc could be half a season. The Oku 2 arc would be another season. Half a season. So you have all these different arcs thrown around. Mix and match them. The only thing you need to make sure is that you don't have an arc with a character that hasn't been introduced yet.
As far as the manga being animated, it's unanimous, and I will sing with the choir on this one. It needs to be animated. Just from the little bit that I've read and been exposed to, it's fantastic. I agree with what Pi said about animating a lot of it, because a lot of it is stuff that people haven't seen. You know, many of the arcs that we're talking about here today, no, but there's a good chunk of people that have probably never even heard of it. There are probably people who probably haven't even heard of the manga itself, and we're still fans of Tenchi, and maybe having a little bit of a recap, but as far as alluding to things that have already happened, I don't think you need to connect anything. Like, if there's anything that was OVA-centric that Okuda tried to tie in, I don't think any of that needs to be there. I think if they were going to make animated adaptations, they need to be one-offs, or they need to be unique arcs that make this animated version of Tenchi from the manga be unique. And so it makes you wonder why they didn't put those up as filler in between, but who knows. But I would definitely say get it animated. It needs to be animated. And as far as stories, the intro arc is what told, just the intro arc with Yukage and Minagi made me want to read this thing and think that it was fantastic just from one or two volumes. So I would say definitely start off with that one, because that would bring people up to speed and everybody would know what's going on. Like, oh, this is still kind of set in the OVA. Kind of, it's set in things that we're comfortable with, but it's about to go into brand new territory that's still fun. The manga is filled with many extraordinary concepts and plot elements, such as Black Light Hawk Wings, or otherwise dubbed as the Black Hawk Wings, a planet of people whose job it is to carve the trees of Jirai into spaceships, and creatures who prey on Jirai tree energy. Which original concept introduced in the manga is your favorite, and has it inspired your conceptions of Tenshi in any way?
Ah, funny you should say that. Well, I've actually got two. The first would be the Black Hawk Wings. Whilst it was very short, that page where, I can't remember who said it now, when they said Bison's light hawk wings are turning black, I thought, oh my god. And, you know, the end of that part of the universe was at hand. I thought, my god, this is serious. I thought Jirai was powerful before, but the thought of this incredible energy going out of control, I thought that really impressed me. And, I mean, whilst I've got no real inclination to actually write anything about it, I do like things that are just short but sweet, and like, I like designing things from it. This probably the one that tops it is the, as I've stated, the Mitsu. As I said, I thought that plot element was brilliant. It's a tiny creature, just so deadly that it's probably the tightest kept secret in Jirai, and if that got out, I don't think Jirai would get out of the next war so easily. But it's also inspired me in another way. I like writing fan fictions, you see. I can't remember what inspired me exactly, but at some point I actually included that Mitsu in my fanfic. I wanted to expand on the subject. By this, I mean the manga story show just the tip of the iceberg of this amazing plot and the danger of this creature. And I felt it could use more depth and danger. And I'm thoroughly enjoying plunging the cast into their darkest story yet. And, oh yeah, if you want to read it, Tenshi When You're In Love 3 on fanfiction.net. Thank you.
Alright, let's see how I can follow that. So, the manga introduces a lot of nifty ideas, as Dagon just mentioned, and among them, there's a lot to list, so I'm going to keep it to the highlights. The first of which, of course, is the Black Lighthawk Wings, which we did not get a lot of coverage on. We got a couple we essentially got about 10 pages of them trying to stop the end of the universe, because Bizen had actually connected itself to all of the other trees of the Dry Fleet and was proceeded to cause a cataclysmic tear in the fabric of the universe as its Lighthawk Wings were turning black. The tree was dying, and they needed some way to essentially disconnect this essentially detonator from the rest of the bomb, taking out all of Tsunami's work. So that was an interesting idea of actually using the Lighthawk Wings, or these Blackhawk Wings, to a cataclysmic effect. But one of the other things that I like that Okuda did that I have not seen in any other continuity, even if you include Duel or if you include Saint Knight's Tale or War and Gemini or whichever way you want to call it, I haven't read Hasegawa's novel, so I'm not sure if this happens in her books, but I bet it probably does in some flavor, is that Okuda gave the Lighthawk Wings weaknesses. They had godlike strengths. They can essentially protect against just about anything, but and also cut through just about anything, as we see with Kagato and Soja. But also, Okuda, in I believe it was Volume 8, I believe, Chapter 2 or 3, they introduce a creature called a Shou. And what it does is it essentially preys on other creatures' energies. It captures Ryoko, copies her, captures Washu, copies her, and proceeds to go around, and then comes up to Tenshi, tries to go after him. Tenshi, of course, does his subconscious protect me Lighthawk Wings move. The Lighthawk Wings pop out, protect him, but just barely scare the thing off. Later, he tries to use the Lighthawk wings again and can't use them. So he, in the context, Tenshi actually thinks to himself, "Oh, I can't use the Lighthawk wings. I can't use the Lighthawk wings. They must need to recharge or something." So there's a time. There seems to be a power limit or a time limit to where he can use the Lighthawk wings, which means that they are limited. Whether that's because of Tenshi or because of the Lighthawk wings or an innate feature of the wings themselves, who knows? I have several theories about what actually caused that, but it made me think, okay, these Lighthawk wings are godlike powerful. You have a mortal using a godlike power. Where can you go with that? And that's something that I think you could really go with if you, for example, did a season of the manga, introduce some of these concepts, and then branch off into even new, more new material with a new writer. That would be, I think that would be a way to go, because in all the other representations of the Lighthawk wings, they've been godlike powerful, not unlike the AT fields of Evangelion. They seem to have these, they seem to be the ultimate weapon of their respective universes. And I've seen a lot of parallels between the two. Look at OVA 3 in the fight between Tenshi and Zed. They seem to act very similar to AT fields at that point, whether Okuda or anyone else was looking at each other at that point, I don't know. Also, you have the unnamed tree. The unnamed tree, what is, you have the Jiraiya's power, whether you look at it as being some kind of innate energy, or if you look at it as being an extension of Tsunami, you have the unnamed tree who has a mysterious ability as to why it was unnamed. Why was it left in the middle of nowhere? There's a lot of whys going on there, and one can ask questions of what is the eventual extent of the Jiraiya's power? What could you do with it? Could you warp time? Could you crack the universe? There's so many theories floating around with that you could have a lot of fun with it. Yume, another reason why Yume is a good character and a fun person to play with is she's a counter to Washu. And a lot of the things that she did, her minions, her three minions she has, Hishima, Mushima, and Takashima, what are called the Shima brothers. And each one of them is a created being, not unlike Ryoko, but in a different fashion. And each one of them seems to have some kind of shtick. In particular, Hishima is a clone of Goge and actually has a lot of his natural strengths, which goes down the cloning route as to how can you mix and match the genetic potential of different races. And one could actually ask, what would happen if you take the genes from a Jiraiyan and the genes of whatever Ryoko is, whatever Washu is, whether you take the universe stance or the OVA stance, put them in a blender, what do you get? And that's a lot of different things that could be inspired from the work that Okuda has done.
I quite like the idea of the Mitsu, you know, this bane to Tsunami that's a feast on her power, and this is top government conspiracy, you know, don't let anyone know about this, that Jiraiya's a weakness and stuff, so yeah, I'd go for the Mitsu.
Well, I mean, I'm no fanfic author, so I mean, I can't really say I've drawn too much inspiration from it, but the one plot element that really got me was the long-running, like, background sort of gags of breaking the fourth wall. Like, every once in a while, the characters would look right at you, the reader, and say, well, hey, Tenshi would say, well, hey, I'm the main character here. Why can't you listen to what I say? Or Washu will pop up in the side of the panel and say, well, for the readers, let's have some explanation here. And then she'll explain what's going on. And it's funny stuff, and it works rather well. I mean, sometimes it's a bit bizarre. On the whole, it's very comical. And it adds a unique flavor to the manga that you really don't see in the shows or the OVAs at all. And so I found that one quite good. The only other thing I could say plot element wise would be the way Yosho's backstory keeps popping up throughout the entire run. Like every once in a while you'll see a little hint of, oh well, there was this one Jiraiyan swordsman who came by here a couple hundred years ago, and it's hinted that it was Yosho, and that things like that pop up all the time throughout all the arcs and little stories. And it's sort of a cool little undercurrent of the whole series itself, trying to put together, oh, well, Yosho was here. And it's very cool stuff like that, but that's my piece on it.
You know, the matched pair of swords that was given to most likely Yosho, and it's pretty well confirmed, later in there, could have had more to them. And you've got the monk that's, you know, like the last of its kind or something like that, if I remember correctly. You've got, you know, a lot of little areas that can be easily expanded upon where, you know, they left it open to interpretation. That's what a good book does. It allows your imagination to fill in the blanks and let it wander and do on its own. So I think to a large extent, it did everything it needed to. The Black Hawk wings are a nice counter. We didn't see enough of them. Like I said, Yume's a nice counter. There's a couple of other areas where they could continue it. I mean, we don't really know absolutely what happened to the Prince of the Planet that died. You know, there's plenty of room to still keep going. I think it can be done. You just have to have people that are willing to do it and enjoy what they're working on.
I was just curious, Pi. You said already you love that. The Evil Lake arc, and I know you've got a fanfic, so I was surprised you didn't reflect on that story inspiring you for your fanfic. Did it not inspire you?
Actually, I was trying not to turn into a blatant advert for my stories, but yes, the Okutu arc with Garyu and the mind-twisted Ayaka definitely influenced my perception of her and how and what you could do with Ayaka in writing.
We're about to wrap it up. Is there anything that anybody would like to add? And I know that JG had made a statement on, was there anything that was a least favorite moment, or anything do you think that could be improved on? And this is just kind of open.
Well, I do have a little gripe about the manga. It's probably just me. Or it just could be the way Okuda drew things. Some parts, you know, they've got that, they've got those big eyes, and there's like everyone going, oh, that's so nice. Like Winter Summer does something sweet. It crosses the line of doing it, you know, over the top, because I think, oh god, turn it down, it just looks daft. That's probably my only gripe. It just feels awkward and stuff.
The one thing that I could say that could be improved, I suppose, is probably how they tie in some other characters, because later in this manga, as the OVA continued, because keep in mind the timeline of this, the original first OVA series came out in 92, and the manga started either, I forget if it's late 92 or early 93, and as such, it drew originally from the original OVA series. It had nothing to do with OVA 2 at first, so for example, Clay isn't mentioned, Tokimi isn't mentioned, etc., and as the manga was going, the anime was being written simultaneously. So every now and then, you'd get a hint, like, especially in the, for example, like the Dark Washu arc, or the final arc with Misaki Kiyone showing up, you have references to what's going on in the manga, and I believe JG or Chuck mentioned this, that occasionally Okuda would poke fun at what's going on in the anime at the moment, or make reference to it, for example, with Clay and dealing with Dark Washu, and those two story arcs tie together. But occasionally you'd have a character show up like Seto, or Kamiki Seto, have her show up. Funaho and Misaki would crop up. I think Azusa, the Emperor, cropped up once and challenged Tenji to a duel. Occasionally might have to kind of weave them in a little bit better, because they seem to just kind of pop up. It's like, if you weren't aware that they existed already, it's like, who's this again? Also, one other thing I think that could be added to the manga, not this run of the manga, I'd like to see Okuda take his hand at writing a universe manga, one that was set in Tenchi Universe instead, and see where he could go with that, because I'd like to see what he could do with the knights, Azaka and Kamidake, or with our favorite bounty hunter, Nagi and Kenoki. I would love to see what he could do with that.
I agree with Pi on some level that I think Okuda did a huge improvement on the handling of Seto and Misaki Kiyone. And I think, honestly, probably Kajishima ripped it to make OVA 3, because it came out OVA 3 after the manga section that dealt with that. But read it, you'll find out. But the two complaints I think I have on the manga, actually I guess three, and the last one's just a tiny one. The first one is I'm not honestly a fan of Minagi. I mean, everybody else is like probably going boo on their side of the mic right now, but she, even on the Wikipedia article, she's referenced as like a equivalent to Zero. To some extent, I think copying Ryoko and making Minagi left the door closed for more development on Ryoko. I mean, we do have the unnamed tree arc and all that. We get to see parts of it, but Ryoko is much more aggressive, much more headstrong, and just barrel your way into every problem. As a result, I would have much rather seen more of like the ending of OVA 2 when Zero and Ryoko merged, and that's never something that's been touched on. It's just dropped dead, and then it never went anywhere. So I kind of think like Minagi kind of distracts or divides Ryoko in a sense, and that's, you know, I just can't really get over that nudge there. I mean, she's a little okay character. She does have her purpose. She does, you know, do things and show up at the right time and all that. But it's just kind of like, we don't need another Ryoko. It's fine as is. The other thing was, again, on Ryoko is, like Dagon said earlier, they constantly pound it into the ground that Ryoko is a marionette or an artificial life form or a, you know, basically a droid or something. And it just cheapens her character to an extent. And of course, she understandably goes into a rage mode and tries to annihilate whoever's saying something like that. You know, one of those moments is when a couple of like bounty hunters literally have their tendrils into Tenchi's brain, threatening giving him permanent brain damage if she doesn't stand down and do what they want. That's not something you're going to see typically. It just, again, kind of cheapened Ryoko. I mean, you don't have to hit on it multiple times. And again, the third thing, again, relates to Ryoko. I guess I'm kind of hitting on it because I've been a, you know, Ryoko fan of anybody in Tenchi, besides maybe Kiyone, is that the ending kind of, again, kind of left on that very last chapter of the book. You know, trying not to do spoilers here, but she basically gets her heart ripped out, almost, and is basically dying for Tenchi. And granted, the story ends on a high note, but it just kind of, there could be done a little bit differently there, I think. And in an anime, it would almost have to be. But those were my three little nuggets of disappointment. Everything else, though, it's still fantastic, and you need to read it. It's just my little tidbit.
Need some more Kiyone as well. Kiyone Makibi.
Yes. I will second that one wholeheartedly. More Kiyone. Also, JG, you asked for it. Boo. Minagi rocks. That's all.
Well, thanks everybody for coming in today and being part of the MangaCast. Long time in the running. Until next time, stay gold.